is John Tisbury, and in this video I'm going to talk you through the Tesla Powerwall installation that we've had. I've had it in for about 2 months now, so it's a recollection on how things have gone since day one, some of the readings and a bit of background about it at sort of high level in terms of the installation and the software and the app and those sort of things. So there you go, we're going to run the intro and I'll see you in a bit. So welcome back. As I said, I'm going to spend a bit of time talking you through the Tesla Powerwall installation. We're based in the UK, just to give you some geography, and it's the middle of winter here. We had the Powerwall, Tesla Powerwall, installed on the 4th of December 2018. Probably not the best time to get it installed with the short daytime that we have here in the UK. Winter-wise, but the other side of the coin there is that we get a chance to see how it works and work our way through it, but also we then move into the better time of the year as the daylight increases as we go into spring and towards summer. We have an existing solar panel installation. It's a 4 kilowatt install with 16 Sanyo panels, which goes into a Sunny Boy inverter, 3.8 kilowatt inverter. We've had that for some time. That was installed in September 2011 and that has paid for itself. It cost us £15,000 to install it back then, and with the feed-in tariff that we've managed to secure then at that point, which was 52 pence per kilowatt hour, we managed to recoup our costs just at the end of last year, actually, December 2018. So a 7-year payback time for that, which was good. They did actually forecast that it would take 14 years to pay back, so which is good, and that we've managed to halve that. What else can I tell you? Yeah, I wasn't going to spend too much time on the solar, so you know that's existing. And what I wanted to do now that the solar had sort of paid for itself and was earning money, was to look at storing the majority of the power that we produce during the day, the excess solar. For two reasons, really. One is that both Jill and I work during the day, so we're generally away. Monday or Tuesday through Friday, so that means that most of the electricity that we produce goes straight back into the grid as excess power. We do turn on like dishwashers and those sort of things on timers, so to make the best benefit and value of the solar generation during the day, but a large quantity of it feeds back into the grid. So we wanted to capture that and then power the house during the evening, hence the Powerwall. So we went with the Tesla Powerwall. We looked at a few others, but the Tesla seemed to be the best in terms of the size and the quality, and it looked nice as well. It's a 13.5 kilowatt, it's actually a 14 kilowatt hour battery with a usable 13.5 kilowatts. And you get a really useful little app with it, so you can monitor usage. You can also do that straight on your computer as well. You can use an internet browser and get into the gateway and monitor it that way. But the app's certainly a lot more convenient. So I'll briefly take you through the app. And what else can I tell you? Oh yes, the other reason, there was two reasons I said. So that's the number one reason, is to capture the excess solar that we create during the day. And the second one is we've ordered an electric car, a PV, EV, and that's due at the end of August. So I wanted to have a charger as well as benefit from having the battery pack to be able to charge the car. So the company we went with to do the install installed our charging point, and also obviously the power wall at the same time, and tied it into the existing PV installation, which all went swimmingly well and very smooth. So let's talk you through and show you some of the bits we've chatted about. Oh, costs. I'm going to tell you about costs before I get into that. Cost for the power wall and the wall charger was 7th. I'm having to look at the screen because I can never remember all the numbers. So £7,100, which is ex VAT to install it all, which included a ZAPPI charger and a myenergi ZAPPI charger. And we've worked out that if we work out the sort of payback time on that, it's about 5 to 7 years, depending on sun really, the amount of sun that we get, and the energy based on our average daily usage for the house. You can monitor, you know, complete usage through the app, which is very, very useful. And you could do that remotely, so you can sit at your desk at work or wherever you are and see how much power is flowing in. So let's take a little bit more detail into the app. And currently it's a nice sunny day, although it's bitterly cold, bitterly cold out there. So it's about freezing, I think, or 1-2 degrees. It's very chilly. In fact, let's just have a look at the weather while we're here. Sunday the 3rd of February 2019, it's 20 to 3, 1440, and it says it should be, oh look, a brisk 4 degrees centigrade, that is, and we've had about 7 hours of sun, or expecting about 7 hours of sun today, so quite a good day for solar generation. So in terms of what the house is doing at the moment, it's drawing 8.8 kilowatts. Generally, if nothing's on in the house, in terms of no one here, and just sort of on tick over, it's between 200 watts and 400 watts, so 0.2, 0.4. Fluctuates between the two based on sort of fridges and what have you kicking in and cycling in and out. We had a bit of a busy day actually today on the power, and the reason for that is the cold. So I've brought up the sort of energy usage today, and if we look at the house today is used, I'm laughing, 35 kilowatts. Typically we would use 20 in a day, 20 kilowatt hours a day. So as you can see, we're heading on for double at the moment what our normal usage is, and two reasons for that. Is that one, I've had my studio, my photography studio heater on, electric heater, and that's pulled power, and Jill's also been in her studio and she's had her heater on, so two additional electric heaters which are pulling a lot of power, so that's why those. Oh, and we've had the washing machine and the tumble dryer on, so it's been a full-on day in terms of electricity usage. We're a four-bedroom house, electric cooking and gas central heating. And yeah, that's about it. It's a fairly modern house, so it's fairly well insulated. What else can I show you? So that's home usage. To date, from the grid, we've pulled in 22.9 kilowatts. We've actually fed back to the grid 200 watts. Solar generated today is 13.6, 13 kilowatts, which is very good for this time of year. And the power wall, what's that done today? So we've sent 1.9 kilowatts to the power wall, and no, start again, John. 3.1 kilowatts to the power wall, and from it so far we've used 1.9, so it's been sort of bouncing in and out today, and I'll just show you that on the app. We'll see there that sort of spike, and what that is showing you, that middle line, horizontal line, is sort of the baseline, and anything below it is feeding to the power wall, and anything above the line is from the power wall, so it's cycling sort of backwards and forwards. between those two, as you can see there. Solar power, as I say, 13.8 kilowatt hours today, and that'll start to tail off now as the sun drops down. It's very low this time of year with the winter sun, so to get a 13, almost 14 kilowatts of power out of a winter's day is actually really, really good. And if I scroll down, the solar panel has sent 75% to the house, 23% of that went to the power wall, and 1.5% went to the grid. And the reason for that is actually down to the temperature, because it's been so cold overnight. It was like minus 5 degrees centigrade. The power wall is liquid cooled. And what happens in really cold temperatures is that it'll minimize or reduce the amount of power that it can safely absorb. So if the solar panels are pumping out a lot of power, it won't all go to the power wall. So the power wall will like throttle back, so it'll safely absorb the charge rather than overheating or taking too much charge in. So that's why some of the power today has gone back to the grid. And under normal circumstances, at normal ambient temperature, that wouldn't happen. You'll notice that we put the power wall outside. The power wall can be installed inside or outside. It's happy doing either. And a lot of people either put them in inside or in their garage. We opted for putting it outside in a convenient location. And it's fine, absolutely fine out there, with that sort of minor limitation that when it's really cold or really hot, it'll throttle back. But it's in a position that doesn't really get too much extremes of temperature. Well, back to the app, and so that's the power flow. So performance today, bringing that up, and we're currently on 30% solar panel and 5% from the power wall. And what will happen throughout the course of the day, as the sun goes down, then any charge left in the power wall will continue to charge the house. If I bring up a spreadsheet on the old computer, I've been tracking day by day the usage. So our best self power so far since we've had the installation is 81%. So solar stroke power wall supported 81% of our power needs. We've done really quite well, all the way from 1% self-power right through to 81%. Since we've had it installed, just out of interest, in terms of the average, the rolling average is 23% self-power, which that's pretty good in the winter. I would expect during the summer that we're 100% self-powered. They reckon over the averaging out over the year, you'll end up about 70-75% self-powered by having the two, the solar panels and the power wall. So we'll monitor that and see how we get on that. The power wall itself, since we've had it installed, say it was installed on Tuesday the 4th of December 2018. Today it's the today is the 3rd of February 2019. I haven't got yesterday's figures in yet, but so far the power wall's provided 8% of our total self power, which means that the solar has managed 14. So that's where we're at. And I'll also show you on the video the ZAPPI charger, which we've got. The reason we went with a ZAPPI charger is that you've got different modes on the ZAPPI. This video really wasn't about the ZAPPI. There's plenty of other really good videos on it. The ZAPPI will allow you to charge at various times, so you can set it to charge the car as a priority. But also you've got the other extreme where you can charge on excess solar. So when you're generating additional solar power that a house doesn't need, you can then sort of trickle charge that into the car. and the car then charges for free. So that's why we went with the ZAPPI charger, because it has that intelligence to be able to meter when it decides to pull and not pull to charge the car. What else did I need to tell you? I think there was something else just dropped into my memory. Obviously now the Powerwall is discharging, so something's clicked on in the house. We're pulling 3.1 kilowatts in the home, and solar is only pulling 2 kilowatts in. So the Powerwall has now made up the difference, the balance of 1.1. So it'll always do solar and Powerwall if there's any charge in there over the grid, to make sure that it works to reduce the pull on the grid. And you can change those settings if you need to. There's a customize option in there. And one thing we're looking to do is go onto an economy tariff. And there's a few energy companies do different tariffs. It used to be in the old days called the Economy 7. That's still available, but a lot of them do different tariffs now. So you can charge your electric vehicle or your Powerwall, in our case, during the cheap rate. So during the winter, when there's little solar available, we could then overnight during that cheap tariff time frame charge the Tesla up to 100%, benefit of that, and then that could discharge during the day during the peak rate times to reduce our electricity usage from the grid. So that's something else we're looking towards. Currently our meter, electric meter that we've got, is the old type, so we need to swap that out to a dual rate meter to be able to take advantage of that. So I'm just investigating that at the moment, so perhaps do one on that as and when we get that. So there you go. So anyway, I'm rambling on a bit. So that's us, that's the Tesla Powerwall 2 installation. I'm sure I'll do another video later on in the summer, perhaps when we've got a bit more data and a bit more sun in terms of duration, to see if we are actually doing 100% self-powered. So any questions, drop them in the comments below. Thumbs up, always appreciated, or thumbs down if it was of no interest to you. And those comments and the thumbs up, thumbs down are really, really helpful, because it helps boost the channel. So please do that if you can. And also a subscription would be nice as well, if you fancy subscribing. I don't do a lot on the solar panels and Tesla. So if you've dropped in onto my channel for that, then perhaps you want to have a look at the other videos, because generally I do photography, cars and models and things like that. So this is a bit of an ad hoc one, but hey, variety and all that. Anyway, thanks for tuning in, and I shall see you soon. All right, take care. Bye.